Blog Talk Radio.
You are listening to Mahogany Says Radio Show with Mahogany Silvering, mahoganysilvering.net. The Rise of Lucius Morningside, Book 2 of the Kenya Clark series by author Mahogany Silvering. Christmas will never be the same. Chaos has taken hold of the city of Atlanta. Children and teens are coming into powers they cannot control. The GBI paranormal unit cannot contain the situation. The cause of this chaos is Lucius Morningside, a.k.a. Lucifer, the devil himself. With his bloodline in Atlanta, he will stop at nothing to make this city his own, establishing himself as a high-powered attorney. Can Agents Kenya and Darren stop him and save the kids, or will Lucius win this round? Rise of Lucius Morningside, Book 2 of the Kenya Clark series, and for a limited time from December 20th to December 24th, Book 1, Tell Me You Love Me, also by Mahogany Silvering, will be free on Amazon. So get both copies today.
Hot Coffee, an interracial romance by Donna R. Mercer. A new release on December 3rd is now available for pre-orders on Amazon. Roman is a playboy, but one too many scandals has put his CEO position in jeopardy. He must find a nice girl, one that the board of Hemingway Industries would approve of, and get married before the new year. Maya is just the woman he needs with her wholesome clean image. Roman is the one man who has ever held a place in her heart, but she has no plans of marriage, only philanthropy. So Roman must prove his love and earn Kamaya's trust, or risk losing it all. Everyone needs a little cream in their hot coffee. An interracial romance by Donna R. Mercer. For more information, visit www.donnarmercer.com. Hot coffee. Get your copy today. You are listening to Mahogany Says Radio Show with Mahogany Silvering, mahoganysilvering.net.
Good evening, everyone. You are listening to Mahogany Says, and I am your host, Mahogany Silvering, and we've got a good show for you tonight. We are talking with none other than fiction author I.L. Davis. Did I say that right?
Yes, you did.
Okay. Do you prefer to go by I.L. or do you like Ira?
Ira's fine.
Ira? Okay. Yeah. We can do that. So tell me, how are you doing today?
Oh, I'm doing good. I'm doing real good. Thank you.
Well, I'm glad to have you with us tonight. So tell us, what inspired you to start writing?
My mom. I actually been drawing these characters in this story my whole childhood, even my teenage and later. And my mom, before she passed away, she made me give my word that I would stop drawing the story I have in my mind and write it so people can actually see this world that I've been drawing my whole life.
Wow. Yeah. That's interesting. Did you think of it as like for a story for children, or was it more geared for adults?
More geared for adults, with all the fighting scenes and things going on in the story. There's a lot of sword fighting and stabbings and beheadings and
A lot of violence.
Yes, a lot of violence in it.
So, would you say? Problem. Oh, that's your biggest thing. Okay. So, have you always wanted to be a writer?
No, actually, I didn't. I wanted to do something with my artwork and my art, but that didn't work out.
Why is that?
I don't know. Years ago, I guess I made some packages of different art drawings and storylines and sent them out to like Dark Horse, Marvels, Image, all the comic books, and only one sent me a letter back thanking me for the, you know, the artwork and the stories that I sent, because I only sent one story with like 5 or 6 characters.
Mm-hmm.
And nobody picked me up, so I just gave up on it, honestly.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that. You shouldn't really give up. You got to keep going, because you never know who's going to say, hey, I like this, and let's do it, you know? It only takes one person.
Well, that's true. That's what I gave my word on my books. So I can't give up on them. I have to. I'm currently writing book 3 now, and I'm making it more adult-themed than the other two, so hoping that's going to work out.
Okay, so is book 2 out yet?
But yes, it's been out for about 3 or 4 months now.
Okay. And what's the title of that one?
Moon Eyes and the Rising of the Two Moons.
Oh, okay. So what was the title of your first book?
Moon Eyes and the Dark Moon Council.
Oh, okay. So Moon Eyes. And these were characters that you were seeing in your mind and you were drawing them. Well, that's amazing that you came up with a story with that. That is really good.
It's like watching I guess you'd say it, for me, it's like watching a little movie that runs in my mind, and
yes.
I just start drawing what I see.
Nice. I wish I could draw. I can see the picture in my head clearly, but I can only describe it. I can't really draw. But that's amazing.
Oh, no,
that's a double talent.
I just did a art/ book signing at the library, showing people that say they can't draw how to break down what they were taught in school and everything they see to draw it.
Uh-huh.
I've taught my nephews and nieces and family members, the younger ones, that watch me draw something. They're like, I wish I could do that. And I'm like, well, I can show you. And then some of their artwork is better than my own now. They're that good. I was like impressed.
Wow.
I couldn't believe it. Yeah.
Oh, that is amazing. So you can teach anyone basically how to draw. See, I would like to learn that.
<It's>
if I can draw the
characters. It's really, it's like cracking the part of your mind open that's art to show you can draw. It's there. You've just never seen it. I guess the way I look at things, break it down to draw it.
Right.
It's there. Isn't it?
It's definitely.
Everything you were taught in school, you can use just your ABCs, your numbers, your shapes, and everything you look at, you can see the letters, the numbers, the shape, and then you just start putting them down on paper.
Oh, that seems pretty cool. I'm going to have to try that.
It's
so as far
like
as your, okay, go ahead. What'd you say?
No, it's actually easy once you see it. Once you get your mind to see it, there's nothing you can't draw.
Wow.
Yeah.
So, when your first book, when was that published, and what was that like for you?
2013. It was a huge accomplishment considering everything that was happening in my life at the time. It was the only light I had at the time. It was, to me, I had dyslexia and trouble reading out loud and stuff, so I've always had problems with writing, and I can draw, but I couldn't. I've always had problems my whole life with writing, and that's argued with my mom, but I couldn't argue much with her. It was under, she ended up passing away from cancer. So,
oh, I'm sorry to hear that.
I couldn't argue
so writing
that
the
much
book
with
kind
her.
Of,
you know?
Yeah. Did it kind
and
of help you?
Kind of? She's like, you have to give me your word before I leave this world. I'm like, oh, man. I said, the one thing I'm very bad at, the one thing I really am, I have problems with. I can do math. I can do everything else. No problems. But this is the only area. And she's like, yeah, and you're going to be great at it. So you're going to give me your word before I leave. And I'm like, okay. So she ended up literally making me say, you have my word.
So that's good.
I started writing and went with Moon Eyes, the characters in my head, and I was like, this is a story I've always seen in my mind. I'm going to start putting it on paper. And I wrote the first one and thought, well, if it flops and doesn't do good, I'm done. And it actually didn't do too bad. So I was like, well, maybe Mom had a point. So I wrote book two and currently trying. I've had writer's block, and I'm trying to write book three now.
So how do you handle your writer's block?
I go to the park, walk, listen to music. Just pretty much it.
It's kind of get away from everything.
Clear my mind. Yeah, clear the mind and relax, and hopefully, you know, I get ideas out there. And I actually had a friend, you're always at the park. I said, it's a great office, isn't it? It's got a beautiful scenery.
I guess that's why a lot of writers tend to write, like, in coffee shops or parks or wherever. They just kind of take their laptop with them. I have not been able to do that, but I... If I'm going to do something else, I'll exercise, yoga, walk outside. But as far as like taking my laptop and sitting down and trying to concentrate on writing, there's too many things going around that I'm just like, would take my attention away. Unless I'm reading a book. That's different
that's
for some
I
reason.
Bring,
yeah.
Bring you a notepad like I do. Laptop's too heavy and all that. But if you bring a notepad, you just write it with a pen, and then you can change or correct it later.
Oh, that's true. You just jot it down.
That's what
I
do. My brother taught me that. My brother, he bought me a notepad, and I was like, what's that for? He's like, you never know. You could get an inspiration of something, and you need to write it down so you can, you know, put it in your story or use it.
Exactly.
So I've done that since. Yeah.
That's very good advice. So what is your writing space
brother.
Like?
What is
so
it?
Seems
I'm sorry.
Like, I'm sorry. Your writing space. What is that like?
My writing space?
Other than like you,
well,
you write. Like your... Oh, okay. Sorry. Your writing space, where do you have a desk, or do you just work out of another room, or...
Oh, no, I have my brother's actually old desk. When he passed away, I got it from him, and that's where I sit, and I'll put my music on and write. Might have a game going on my phone. I usually have two things going on while I'm writing, at least. It helps.
Yes.
Because, I feel if you focus on your story too hard while you're writing it, then it's not going to flow. You're just going to keep hitting a brick wall because you're overthinking it. But if you can try to relax the mind will let it come on through, I guess.
That's true. I will actually do that. Music is one thing that is not a distraction for me. I can actually write with music.
That's
it
me.
Kinda actually,
it's the only thing I found.
Yeah.
That's the only thing I found. If I put the music on my cover the ears, put the headphones on, have the music playing in the background while I'm reading what I wrote, I'm golden. But there's too much other stuff going on. Yeah,
sometimes I like to have just something in the background, unless, you know, it's too distracting. But, I can sometimes watch TV, but I'll tend to block it, and it's just, like, noise in the background.
Yes, I do that too.
Just to kind of, okay, so I'm not, because I will sit here and overthink something.
Yes.
Like, you know, when you're in a good space, you just kind of flow, and then other times it's like, Where was I going with
backing
that?
Your, like I did the other day, I backed myself in the corner of my, well, I put my characters and everything, I backed them into a corner, and then my brain shut off, and I went,
oh no,
how am I going to get out of this? And then spider's locksmith. Because I don't want to overthink it, and I'm actually stepping into, I was informed that if I want my books to grow, I need to step up into writing love scenes in my book.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm attempting my love scenes in this book. This book's going to be a little different than the other two. And
so what's the main premise of your book? What's the ultimate story that you're telling through Moon Eyes?
You got to fight the odds you were born with and beat them. You can't. The world might kick you down, but they can't keep you there.
That's good. I like that.
Yeah. I have been drawing, and my dad did not like my artwork. He didn't like my drawing. He thought it was just the dumbest thing in the world, and it caused me a lot of problems with him growing up. It was a very bad scene. And until I got into high school, and the art teacher, it was an ArchuTech class. And I thought it just said art on the door, so of course I signed up for it.
Mm-hmm.
And I got in there and found out it's not a art class, it's ArchuTech. He's going to teach us about buildings.
Yes.
And me and him had a bit of an argument, and he had all these pictures around the room that he had personally drawn. And I went, I got to go switch classes. He's like, why? I said, this is not art. This is about buildings. Me making a building, this is not art. And he's like, buildings are art. I said, no, not in my opinion. I said, most of your famous buildings have some kind of sculptures. They have
exactly.
some kind of paintings.
True.
That's what, you know, makes it art to me. But a square brick on a piece of land to me is not art. And one of my friends said, why don't you just have him draw one of your drawings you got on these walls? And he looked at me and said, so you're an artist? And I went, well, yeah, I guess. I said, everybody saves me a page or two in their, you know, yearbooks to put whatever kind of artwork I want to put in it of my medieval fantasy in my head.
Nice.
And he challenged me to draw this eagle head. So I did, and slid it over by his, and it looked exactly the same. And I ended up taking the class and passing it, but I wasn't happy with it. We studied more about making a building than drawing or actual art. And, yeah.
Well, at least you learned some things there too about structuring things.
Yeah, it was something. But it was years before my mom and dad actually just, you know, thought that I could do something with my artwork. So
mm-hmm.
it was too late at that point. I used to have a ton of artwork drawings I've done over the years. And when Hurricane Katrina hit the coast, it put all my artwork in the Gulf of Mexico.
So, oh, no.
Yeah. All the drawings I kept over the years of this world, and they went out in the Gulf of Mexico somewhere.
Oh my goodness! I know we lost a lot of stuff too with the flooding. Yeah, mostly a lot of pictures and things when the kids are little. But yeah, to lose all of your work, that's got to be hard. But it seems like you're doing well with the books, and you're actually putting them into where people can, you know. Because writers paint pictures with words. So you're still an artist. But now you're just doing it with words as well. So I'm pretty sure you can visualize your world. So what is the name of the location? Did you build this world up? Or was it just as you saw it?
You know, You got me on that one right offhand. I just drew a blank. I know the bad area I send them to. I named Kel Helm. Yeah. For the life of me, I cannot remember their country I named offhand.
Well, terrible. That's all right. For those of you who are just joining us, you're listening to Mahogany Says, and we are interviewing author I.L. Davis, who also, you can call him Ira, and he writes fantasy fiction. And so we're going to take a little break, and while you mull it over, Ira, we'll be right back.
You are listening to Mahogany Says Radio Show with Mahogany Silvering, mahoganysilvering.net. Chew Ink Minimum, Book 1 of the Permanent Hangover Series by Michelle Prince. All Finn Gardner wanted was some fresh air when he stepped out into the alley behind the Permanent Hangover Bar and Tattoo Parlor. Instead, he found someone who needed help. His help. Bailey Parson escapes her life in Chicago to find a better one in St. Paul. Not only does she win over the customers and staff with her smart wit and empathy, she wins over Finn as well. But when Bailey's past threatens their relationship, Finn has a decision to make. Just how much of his dark past does he need to unlock to save her? Chew Ink Minimum by USA Today bestselling author Michelle Prince. Get your copy on Amazon today. You are listening to Mahogany Says Radio Show with Mahogany Silvering, mahoganysilvering.net.
And And we're back. You are listening to Mahogany Says, and I am your host, Mahogany Silverreen, and we are chatting with fantasy fiction author I.L. Davis. So, Ira, did you think of the name?
No, ma'am, I sure didn't. I don't remember, actually, I don't remember ever giving it a name. I just described where they live in the book.
Oh, wow.
And their race and who they are, because I was sitting there thinking about it, and I did not name it, because I believe when I first wrote that book, the Indians, your Cherokees, Choctaws, your natives never mentioned a name. It was just their home. So that mm-hmm. might have something to do with it when I was writing it.
Oh, but, okay.
Yeah, I only named the bad places.
Well, yes, those are what stand out, aren't they?
Yeah, that's true. And I think only in book two do I actually start giving places names, as in book two.
Okay. And what are the names of your main characters?
Moon Eyes, Dead Dog, Gankus, Brother Knight, Alyssa, which actually, due to a typo, became Alias in book one, but I changed that and corrected it in book two. Her name was supposed to be Alyssa. Ruth is one of my favorites and characters in my book. She's part of the Bone Clan race. Let's see. Now you get that. So yeah, there's that.
Oh, so
they're
all different tribes or different or
yes,
different clans.
They're all from different tribes. I introduce towards the end of the book one a couple of characters that become involved in the main group, and that's Gankus. He's a human, and one other. I can't. Oh, I'm drawing a blank on my own books. I'm killing myself.
it's all right. That actually happened.
yeah. But
I know, if you write it down, we'd be able to remember, but sometimes that's not always true.
Yeah.
So, believe me, it happens. It happens.
But yeah, he becomes one of my main characters and one of my favorite to write, because I write him as he's a warrior, but he's kind of like, I guess you'd say, a Bugs Bunny type warrior. He has a bit of a mouth on him, and he's like saying stuff in the middle of the fight, or smarting off, or, you know, challenging somebody, you know, it's the way I wrote him. He carries a flask under his chest plate so he can drink, have a sip in the middle of a fight.
Oh, wow. This is like an interesting character.
And he's my fave. He uses a double-bladed battle axe as his choice of weapon.
Oh, nice.
That's why I said he's my human character amongst the Moon Elves, the Bone Clan people, and the other races that I mixed in. It's basically about uniting different people to show what
right.
they can accomplish.
Oh, okay. So what was your favorite part to write about?
The fight scenes.
The fight scene. I should have guessed that, right? Yeah. You did say you had a lot of violence. I should have guessed that one.
The favorite part is the fight scenes. That's where, growing up, I started studying martial arts.
Mm-hmm.
Got into fighting, some street fighting. And it's one of the things I'm good at. So I reflect back on the different fights I've watched personally and the different things that I've watched, you know, on TV and all, and know my own fight style.
Yeah. You could actually choreograph a fight scene.
Yes, very much. In the book, the way I write them, I see them in my head go down like that. So I'm trying, I'm wanting book three cover to be different than book one and two. I'm trying to find the right person, which I think I have, to actually dress her in Moon Eyes' outfit. Like, she would be Moon Eyes. and go with that is what I'm thinking, because I'm stepping up the book with the love scenes. I want to try and step up the cover a little bit, because I like drew the covers, designed them, and then told them to the people who I hired to make them exactly what I wanted.
Okay. So did they follow, or did you still have to like send it back and say, no, I'm not happy with this?
Yeah, I did that for about 5 weeks. Every week I'm like, this is not it. No, let's see. You and I'm like sending pictures. I'm like, I need you to get closer to this. This is what I have in my mind. This is what I'm looking for. And book two cover, that took about 3 weeks to get the lady to understand. You have everything perfect with the moons and the waterfall, because that's where they live.
Mm-hmm.
I need, the characters do not look right.
Wow.
It's like people want me to draw. And I think when you read a book, you read it for your imagination. You read it to escape this world. And if I put my drawings in there saying what I believe they are, I don't think that's really the way to go. But that's just a personal opinion. I believe your own imagination could probably draw in your mind better characters than I could draw on paper.
Ah. Well, since you are coming from an artist standpoint as well, I think you probably paint a really good picture. But to you, I've seen it. And you, because you have, you know what it looks like. Because the story came from your mind. So you know, in essence, more or less what it's supposed to look like. So you ever thought about doing your own cover or drawing it?
No, I've thought about it, but I like what the book covers I have, and I like the way they turned out, so I was happy with them. Like the eyes on book one, was very important to me, because that's the main character. And then I put the moon up there, because that way you would see the moon and the eyes, and then you'd understand moon eyes. Because
mm-hmm.
I've had people actually say moonies, and I'm looking at them, no, it's moon eyes. Yeah, I actually did that on purpose with the moon above the eyes to give you, to literally put the name with a picture.
Yes, because, it's very beautiful the way it came out. I like that it's got the two moons and then the waterfall coming down.
Yep, that's the rising of the two moons. So there's two moons in the sky. That's actually one of the scenes in the book I wrote. It's a very important scene in the book too. It's a change of events. It's a new race I'm introducing in the book, and that's the beginning of the new race right there.
Oh, okay.
Of that scene of the book, and that, to me, I was like, for the book cover, I want something that stood out in my head, and that's what came out the most of the book. Book one is a short book. It's an easy read. And book two, I really pushed every limit I had on it to make it much longer than book one, because I didn't want to, that bad review of the book was way too short.
And that's really not a bad review. If they're saying it's too short, it's because they want it to have more. So I wouldn't take that as negative. I think, most people say, well, it's too short, I want it more. That means they want, you to add to it because they really got into the story. Now, if they were saying, it was fine. But if they're telling you it's too short, it's because they want to know more, So that's a good thing.
That's
I had a few of those, too.
Yeah, that was the goal with book two, and currently book three is as thick as book one, but I'm nowhere near done. I really want it to be as thick as book two, if not thicker, is my goal.
It's kind of a novel length.
Yes. Yes. That's the goal, so I don't hear them. That I like the reviews of people that's bought my book and talked to me personally at like book signings that have bought it when I've redone them. of book signings, and they said they fell in love with book two. They said they felt book one was too short. They got into it, and then it hit, and then the book comes to an end, because I don't like cliffhangers. I'm not a cliffhanger person. I like beginning, middle, end of a book. You can end it with a cliffhanger that's going to go into some other area, or you're going to start again going to another, area, another way with it. But I don't like when I finish a 300 or 400 page book, it says, and it leaves me hanging on what's going to happen next. the arrows and everything.
Yes.
So when I try and write to where my books can stand on their own, even though they are together, if that makes sense.
So they're a series, but they're like standalone, each one.
Yeah. They're a series, and if you just, I ended this first in book one, I end that, saga, and then I pick up in book two going into another one.
Okay.
But if you don't read one, when you get into book two, because book one has all your description of the races and the people, and I kind of overdone it on the description of who and everybody was and building the world, and then I go into the storyline. And if you get book two, it can stand on its own, but at the same time, you're going to miss out a lot of history of how these people got to where they're at and what they're doing.
Okay. And the first book was called Moon Eyes. What was it again? I'm sorry.
Moon Eyes and the Dark Moon Council.
Moon Eyes and the Dark Moon Council.
Dark Moon Council.
Okay, so the second one is The Rising of the Two Moons.
Yes.
Okay. So.
And I have no clue yet what I'm naming book three.
Yeah, for the third one. Is the third one have a name yet? No clue yet? Okay.
Not yet. No clue.
So mainly your books are on Amazon, or where else can they find the two books?
There, book one is on 2,500 different websites, Books A Million, Barnes & Noble. It's all over the book pages. But book two is only on Amazon right now.
Oh, okay. And this is the one that came out a couple of months ago?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Oh, so March of this year?
Yep.
Right. Okay.
So a few months ago, then.
Yeah.
The time flies, right?
A little bit. Yeah, it does. Especially when, as soon as we hit September, it just seems like October, November, December just fly.
Yeah.
It really does. It's just like, it just goes.
It does. I'm sitting there thinking, wow, has it been that long? Okay.
Yeah. For some reason,
quite
yeah,
a few
it does.
Back.
but that's okay. I mean, if you're going to make it a long book, so you need time to go ahead and flesh out book three. So
I'm working on it.
You work. So do you have a set time that you write, or do you do this full time, or you have another job?
I work full time at my job, so if mainly it's real late on my days off, like during the late hours of the morning. That way everything's kind of calm and peaceful, and there's nothing that can distract me. I can just throw my music on, try and type something out. Focus more on the book without overdoing it.
True. Okay.
I actually live with my sister and her family, so unfortunately, I don't have my own place right now, and it's a very active house.
Right. Well, so it's difficult to find time to really write.
Yeah. So if I wait for everybody's in bed, everybody's asleep, everybody's done, and then I try and set up and. Hopefully not be too tired from my job I work to keep writing.
Oh, okay. Yeah, it's best for me to use headphones. I find that makes it a little easier to block out, because I have a 80-pound lap dog, German Shepherd, who likes to be right up, and as soon as she hears anybody move in the house, there she goes barking.
they have cats here, and there's three of them. And they all three love to run across the keyboard or jump in front of the screen or jump in my face. And I'm looking at them like, trying to write here, people.
They're like, you're not really writing. You want to play with me, right? You're not really doing this.
Yeah.
You didn't really want that word here, did you? Yes, I'll get out of your way, but you know, like right now, you know, any other time, they don't be bothered with you. But as soon as you sit down,
on the bus. They're looking like, all right, guys, he's trying to do something. We can't have that.
Oh, no.
And then, there's three cats, and then the cats are jealous of each other, so they're fighting, and you're like, look, you'll take that somewhere else.
Great.
That's great.
Exactly.
Great.
So what is your favorite food?
My favorite food? Spaghetti.
Spaghetti.
Yep. Spaghetti. Italian style.
Ah, so no meatballs?
Spaghetti, yep.
Like my husband says, it's all about the sauce. It's all about the red. That's what he said.
Tell your husband, he's absolutely right.
Yep. He's part Italian. He's half Italian. Well, his mother's Italian. His father's Dutch. So he's...
Right.
He loves his pasta.
Exactly. I can agree with it.
Yeah, no, I'm more of a lasagna fan.
It's still pasta. It's just flat.
It's still pasta. It's just, it's kind of like... it's flattened and it's kind of like a square thing. I don't know. It's almost kind of like a cake to me, but it's, you've got the cheese and the meat and all the layers and it's just, I don't know. It's interesting. It's not quite as messy as trying to twist, has me all fancy with the fork and twisting it up and in the spoon. And he's like, I was like, look at this professional. He can eat a huge bowl, too. I'm just looking at him going, how do you do that? I try to twist it on the spoon and it's going to go flying somewhere.
That's terrible.
I know. I'm really supposed to be this really sophisticated person. So that is why I will not order spaghetti if we go out to eat. Because I'll be the first one. Same thing with seafood. I am not a person who uses any kind of utensils. I'm from New Orleans. We just break it open with our hands and we chew on it. And, we do not use anything else. So do not take me to a seafood restaurant because I will embarrass you. Like, forget the bib. We eat seafood. We're going to get messy. So
that's terrible.
I know, right?
but probably fun at the same time.
Oh, yeah. And I've actually gotten pretty good at it where I can get a whole piece of meat out of that one section without having to break it up. I was like, I'm not going to use that. I'm just going to mess it up. My fingers are better. So what was your dream job when you were younger?
Well, my dream job when I was a kid was to do something that had to do with, like, movies, art, comic books, anything like that. I guess something to do in the entertainment world when it comes to that. My mom used to, oh my God, she loved movies when Star Trek came out and all these shows, and she had to grab me and put me right by her the whole time watching them. And I'm looking at her like, what are we doing? She's like, it's a good movie. You're watching it. All the way into my adulthood, she would show up at my place and be like, all right, what are you doing? Nothing, right? Yeah, get in the car. We're going to the movies. And literally, that became a tradition. If I, you know, my day off, she found out, she's at my house, we're going to see a movie. So I'm like, what movie? It doesn't matter. We'll pick it when we get there. She loved watching movies, man. She loved the old movies, the new movies. I mean, she was a huge Stephen King fan. Huge.
Oh,
thought
my
every book the man wrote. Loved him.
So, yeah, I couldn't watch the movie. The book scared me enough.
Yeah. She loved his books. She loved his movies. I mean, just, I thought, you know, watching that growing up, how these movies and shows, like, trigger so many emotions in people. If I could be part of that world to where, you know, I think that would be the ultimate dream for me, personally.
Oh, okay.
Doing something that, because, you know, it's kind of a childhood thing, but still. Like, everybody that reads my books keeps going, this would make an incredible movie. And I'm like, yes, it was in my mind.
Wow.
It still is. And they're like, what? I said, it's like watching a movie for me in my mind unfold.
Really?
And I write it down. And, you know, and the fight scenes, of course, is where it gets really intense. And I don't have fake heroes. My heroes get hurt. They get banged up. They get,
right.
You know. I don't, you know. So for me, you know, that's a true hero. You come through the fire. You get beaten down. Whatever way is attacking you, friends, family, the world, your job, but you still get to, you know, you still stand up, you know, push through it for your goals, then you're the true hero of your own story.
Exactly. Like Rocky, it's not about how many times you get knocked down, it's about how many times you get up.
Oh, big fan.
Yes.
I love that movie. That's my favorite.
Every time it comes on, we have to watch it.
You got to rise above whatever's trying to keep
That's
you down.
Right. Exactly.
I love that movie. That's my, because of that one line.
Mm-hmm.
Quit looking around you for something to blame. Do something about it.
Exactly.
That's why you don't give up.
Just keep doing it. Just keep going forward.
That's all we can do, my.
Yeah, because, I mean, eventually, you know, we're going to get where we're going. It's just, you know, sometimes we don't know how to deal with what's happening right now, and we lose sight of what will be because we're focused on what is.
Yeah.
And I'm saying that for myself, too, because I have to remind myself not to do that. It's like, okay,
uh-huh.
I know what's right now, but I know it's not where I'm going to stay. So
that's only a temporary spot.
Exactly. This is temporary.
Right.
This too shall pass. My mom used to say that. This too shall pass. So just get up, keep going.
I'm trying to remember that quote I read the other day on Facebook. It was Snoopy and Charlie.
Oh, well,
we only live once, to Snoopy. And Snoopy said, no, you live every day. You only die once.
Ah,
really good.
Wow, that's true.
You live every
day.
You only
live every day. You only die once.
For me, it'll be dying twice. I died in a car wreck when I was 17. I was
DOA
for 30 minutes. Yeah.
So you were declared dead
DOA.
For 30 minutes. Wow.
Yes. So for me, it'll be two times.
For two times. Well, see, well, doesn't actually count because you didn't stay dead, so you came back. That's because you had a purpose. See, and, you know, God brought you back. You, there's something you had to do. So
I'll be on
it wasn't
round
your time.
Two.
You're round two. Yep. Said nope, we're not out
I
yet.
I remember the doctor standing beside the bed saying, "All right, I'm gonna call it." And I remember the only thing, I was paralyzed from the neck down. It was a really bad wreck. I was completely shredded. Like, all my guts, my insides, everything got tore, ripped, shredded. And I remember rolling my head over, and I could only see out my left eye because it had removed the top of my head, got removed of my hair and skin and all. And I looked over and went, I'm not dead yet. And he just kind of freaked. And then I had like 20 people around me just sticking me and putting stuff, you know, needles in me, putting blood back in me. And I'm just like, wow. And if I'll never forget that.
Wow.
You
definitely have a calling in your life.
His expression, like, I'll never forget. I just rolled my head, the only thing I could move, and looked with my one eye that's working, went, I'm not dead yet. And he just, I need help, people. It's funny, though, it wasn't then.
Probably shook him up a little bit. He's probably looking at it like, oh, this guy's gone, you know.
He's out of here. All right, let's go have lunch. Hold up.
Oh, he's back.
He's back.
Wow.
I got told a week later I'd be dead by the age of 23 because my body was ripped and tore up and all that. And I just celebrated November 49.
Wow. Also, we're the same age. Celebrated 49 in September, so that is amazing. I almost died a couple of times myself last year. So this is, that's pretty amazing. Okay, so do you have any wisdom you would like to share with aspiring writers who think, I'm writing this, but I don't know if I want to publish it? What would you say to them?
I would have to, one of my personal inspiration is, I'm probably going to butcher her name. I do have a speech impediment on certain words and letters. Sherilyn Canyon. She writes the League series. In her book, she put that if she would have stopped when her books were not taking off, she would not be where she's at right now. And I think she has like 31 bestsellers. I mean, she's out there. She's in that top genre of best-selling authors and everything. And it kind of inspired me to keep writing. So I continued. I gave my word I would write. I did write the book, the first book. But after that, I was like, well, it's a gray area now. But I would tell anyone, whatever your dreams are, whatever your goals, it doesn't matter how many times you fall. It doesn't matter how many times you get put on your knees. You can't stay there. You have to push forward. You have to stand back up. You have to. If you have dreams, you have goals, no one's going to hand them to you. No one's going to give them to you. You have to show the world what you have and just keep praying and hoping that the day will come where somebody realizes what your potential is that can help you go forward.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Because it will. There's lots of people who are very famous today, and they almost quit right before their quote-unquote big break came. They were about to quit.
I had a bad book signing about a week ago. They double-booked me with a violin player, and no one noticed me. They didn't notice my stands or me or my books, and I'm just like, everybody was focused on the violin player. I did sell three copies that day, but three sets. But at the same time, I'm like, no one's going to notice me. That guy can play. They literally stayed by him, threw money in his violin case, tips he was playing for. And I was like, well, at least I have good music to listen to instead of your regular store boring music.
There you go. So you have something nice to listen to. Well, that's a good way to look at it. There we go.
It was the one before that was a great book signing, but that one was bad. I was just like, wow, I'm over here stuck in the floral area where all the plants are, so my desk is behind the plants. I'm behind the plants. Mm-hmm. You're not going to see me.
probably
look funny to people walking in, looking over that way, and see my head through the plants and all. Like I'm just like sitting there. Yeah, it went real bad. Oh, it did. It took me behind the plants. I wonder what it looks like to people who are walking in here and looking over, and there's some white guy sitting in a chair looking at
me. Yeah. Oh, my goodness.
I just started laughing. The lady walked up. She's like, hey, and asked about the books. And I kept a smile most of the time because of that. I'm like,
right. Wow,
this is I am behind the plants, man.
It made you more mysterious,
right? Over here.
Like, what's going on behind the plants, right? You have to move the plants.
Yeah,
hey, there's someone here.
Yeah.
I'm over here.
My books are over here. I'm over here. Yeah. Walk past the violinist, please, and you shall see me. Not in the plants, but just behind them.
Well, I have really enjoyed speaking with you tonight, and I'm sure that everyone listening in, and we are listening to Ira Davis, but his author name is I.L. Davis, and he has written some fantastic books, Moon Eyes. I keep forgetting the first title, Moon Eyes. What was the first
Moon
one?
Moon Eyes and the Dark Moon Council.
Moon Eyes and the Dark Moon Council.
Yes.
And then
book one and book
Moon Eyes, the second book is Moon Eyes, Rising of the Two Moons.
Yes, nailed it.
And do you have a website or a place where they can find out more about you?
I.L. Davis on Facebook. I have a Twitter and a Instagram account, but honestly, I don't get on them as much as I guess I should. But I do check my I.L. Davis on Facebook page.
Okay.
I do check it.
All right. So, everyone, you have heard it right here on Mahogany Says. And you can find I.L. Davis and his books on Facebook. So, thank you so much for joining us. I thank you, everyone, for tuning in tonight. And even though we had a second guest lined up, but you know, sometimes things just work how they work. So, I'm glad I got to spend this time with you talking and learning about your life and learning about how you have died twice. Not everybody can say that. So it was so great to meet you, and I thank you for doing the show tonight.
All right, thank
so,
you, dear. Overdone
we'll
one. The second
you.
Time is later, hopefully, a lot later.
Right. Well, let us know when the third book comes out, and I can have you on again, and we'll talk about that one. How's that?
Oh, that'd be awesome. Thank you.
All right. Well, thank you very much. You have a good night.
You too, dear.
You are listening to Mahogany Says Radio Show with Mahogany Silvering, mahoganysilvering.net. The Rise of Lucius Morningside, Book 2 of the Kenya Clark series by author Mahogany Silvering. Christmas will never be the same. Chaos has taken hold in the city of Atlanta. Children and teens are coming into powers they cannot control. The GBI Paranormal Unit cannot contain the situation. The cause of this chaos is Lucius Morningside, a.k.a. Lucifer, the devil himself. With his bloodline in Atlanta, he will stop at nothing to make this city his own, establishing himself as a high-powered attorney. Can Agents Kenya and Darren stop him and save the kids, or will Lucius win this round? Rise of Lucius Morningside, Book 2 of the Kenya Clark series. And for a limited time from December 20th to December 24th, Book 1, Tell Me You Love Me, also by Mahogany Silvering, will be free on Amazon. So get both copies today. You have been listening to Mahogany Says with Mahogany Silverine at mahoganysilverine.net. Thank you and good night.